And ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure to be here. And two things I'm going to say. Everybody got a power carry along, okay? I'm reliably informed that my slides, as well as some resources I'm going to refer to, are actually available on the memory stick. So if I don't stick to my slides, don't worry. You have information. All you need to do is actually go and put it in your computer. You should be able to upload and get what the resources I have put together, as well as my presentation slides. I know I'm between your lunch, and so I'll try and stick to the half hour. In fact, I try and do it in less because I don't want to be blamed for somebody going hungry. I grew up in a society where food was scarce, so we had to do a marathon every time we had the opportunity to eat. So two things I'm going to say about education, and maybe I'll use three stories, very quick ones, to encapsulate what I'm going to say during the next while. Number one, two friends of mine from Dublin, I call them Sean and Mary. They are very popular names. They have one thing in common. The two of them were interested in immigration, mainly because of their encounter with me, and they approached me to ask me if there was anything they could do. So we went through a whole list of things they could do. So in the end, we said, okay, why don't we think about doing some work? One of them did some work in homework clubs, actually, in Dublin. And the other one did something even more profound because she agreed to become a mentor to students who happen to be the so-called unaccompanied minors. I don't like using the labels, but those are children who are here and who don't have their family members to work along with them and so forth. And recently, the person who was working with a particular migrant, young migrant, she got a job in Vienna. And she rang me to ask me for advice, whether she should take up the job or stay in Dublin. Then I asked her, I believe you are supporting somebody over the last while. Have you considered what will happen to this mentee of yours if and when you leave the stage? And she said, I have not thought about it. I said, go and think about it. Come back, we can talk about going to Vienna. The other one is still active, and we met, he was a young man. We met in the year 2000, and he is as active as ever with the migrant communities. But education is more than just the classroom. It's also about what happens in the outside world. And this is where I'm keen to stress we all have a role to play in terms of promoting integration. I use an anecdote to highlight, and then I go back to my slides. When I was new here, I happened to meet a friend who had worked in Africa as a missionary for a long time. This is 1996. And our friend got sick. She was ill. And here I was. When somebody is ill in my society where I come from, what do you do? You go to pay them a visit in the hospital. Okay? That's what you do, standard. But I was here. Although I was educated, I could speak English, I did not feel I had enough cultural competence to know what to do in the situation. I rang a friend of mine, whom I'll call for argument's sake, let's call him Father Fitzpatrick, because I know we had a few missionaries in Africa from Ireland and so forth. So when I rang him, he told me, Fidel, you may not go to visit a person in the hospital without their consent. Placed a phone call. I was lucky she was in a private room, so she had a phone. I rang her, and she said I could go in. Another friend of mine, who was also her friend, did it the African way, went in without consent. And I can say the outcome was not as expected because the person was a little bit annoyed that the person presented without. So everybody needs to develop their intercultural competence, and that's where education comes in. So you have an overview of my presentation, but as I said, we will not necessarily stick to the script. Suffice to say that when you think about integration, there are a lot of policy framework. If you think about Ireland, we have been at it starting in 1999 when we had integration at way process, which was developed actually for integrating refugees at the time. We moved on, we had the National Action Plan Against Racism, and in 2008, we had our Migration Nation, which was published by the then Minister for Integration, Kanaanhan. And since then, obviously, we have had the intercultural education strategy, and as you know, we are in the process of developing an integration strategy. I don't know how many people wrote submissions when there were calls for submissions for an integration strategy. How many in the room? No? Yes, I can see a few hands. The reality is, I mean, yes, we had a lot of submissions, but I would have loved to see more, because the more views are shared, the more we are likely to come up with solutions and recommendations. I was involved in two submissions, and I see somebody in the audience who is aware of it. One of them was as Immigrant Council of Ireland at the time where I worked, and the other one was a group of us who decided, okay, we are going to come up with our own set of recommendations. And one of our set of principles was, whoever lives here belongs here. Whoever lives here belongs here. Okay? So I think that's the key message. And we, as people who are here today, who made an effort to be here today, when you go back to our community, that's the message we have to go and portray. There's no point of talking about what the government is doing or what the government is not doing if we, as individuals, were not engaging in the issue. We can't pretend Ireland is going to be where it was when I came here in 1995. We are moving forward. And as we move forward, we have to develop our own intercultural competence. We have to help those people who have made Ireland their home, help equip them to develop their own cultural competence and allow them to achieve their dreams. And education is but one of the things we have to think about. So if you go to the EU, they developed the so-called principles for integration, and I'm just mentioning two of them here. One of them is about integration in terms of preparing the second generation. The other one is about frequent interaction between migrants and members of the migrant communities and so forth. But if you read number 7 further, which is not on the script here, shared forums, intercultural dialogue, education about immigrants and immigrant cultures, stimulating living conditions in an urban environment to enhance interaction between immigrants and member state citizens. I mean, that's the key. But as the minister says, I don't necessarily buy into the whole notion of 3D integration. I don't know how many people have heard of 3Ds. Dance, dish, dress. I think we have to move beyond that. And you know, having people having some seminars and so forth, it is great. But it has to be a starting point. It shouldn't be the end. And that's a message which I can't speak loudly enough about. But definitely, we are here today. Let's individually decide what it is we are going to do. You know, you'll be inspired. Go and do it. Don't wait for somebody else to do it. The mayor can open the platform for us, but it's us to go and leave whatever we said here and leave it in the community. Okay. So I have tried to pull out some of the experiences of, in terms of education, from countries with immigration history, and I don't need to read any of those, and as I said, the resources are available. You can go and find out, and I have given you a reference so you can go and find the documents. They are available online. I don't need to read anything. All we can say is, if you don't succeed in terms of education, for the second generation, 1.5 generation, what will tend to happen is they will not feel part and parcel of a community. If you look at what is happening in the UK at the moment, they have this sort of, you know, they are investing a lot of money in terms of combating what they call radicalization. And radicalization occurs when you don't identify with where you live. So education is one of the ways you can use actually to help people to identify themselves with the state, to develop a sense of ownership, a sense of identity, so that they feel they are part of the society. But obviously, if you are excluding people in education, you are likely to exclude them in employment, in housing, and the circle continue repeating itself. And it is not going to help anyone. So it is in our best interest, actually, for people to succeed in terms of integration in the school, but also in the wider society, because then we don't have to invest a lot of money in trying to repair the damage which can be caused by lack of integration. Okay. I'm conscious of, So here are some ideas of what works. So again, I have the references, they are there. But by and large, if you look at Europe and you look at the Nordic countries, you look at Canada, successful educational integration occurs where there is late, how do you call it? You know, they have track systems in some countries whereby when you are a certain age, you are classified in a certain category. So it is better to do it later in life to allow people to grow and eventually we don't develop at the same time to get the intercultural competence which will allow us to flourish and become the people we want to be. But unfortunately, if you look at some countries which I don't necessarily want to name, you realize that most people of migrant background don't actually go to university. And if you think about it, we are moving towards what they call knowledge-based economy. So how will you be involved in knowledge-based economy if you have no education? It won't work. If manufacturing is moving on to other countries, obviously you have to prepare people to work in the services industry. And unfortunately, you are not going to get a job in those industries unless you have the education. So it is key to make sure that people succeed in education. Okay, so now, which brings me to another one, which is the elephant in the room, is literally the whole idea of, discrimination. What does it mean? And how does it manifest itself? Some of them have been discussed earlier on. Individual discrimination, everybody knows about it. I don't need to spend too much time talking about it. But subjectively perceived discrimination reflects really occurring unequal treatment, but it could also be rest on false perception of reality or interpretation that there is discrimination in a given situation. If you think about conformity discrimination, is an unjustified equal treatment. So for example, I was raising my family here. If you think about the hairstyle, you are a school administrator, you are hoping to get everybody to respect the code of practice and so forth. How do you trim your hair? And how does it change in various contexts? What is short hair for some might be long hair for others. So whatever messages we give, we have to challenge those messages because actually you might be discriminating without knowing what it is we are doing. And obviously there is also opportunistic discrimination. It is when, for example, you are not acknowledged or appreciated or your presence is not. Think about the school curricula, think about the books you read, think about the portray of some of those migration countries when, on television, in some ads, obviously, when you need to raise money. So sometimes they have to question whatever you are doing because it might have a negative impact on the people you are trying to protect. Institutional discrimination, I don't need to spend too much time about it. We have read and heard about it. But denied support discrimination is something else I want to bring to their attention. It's a situation where if you are vulnerable and don't get support, in other words, you don't have English language support, for example, and you don't get it in school, it is going to affect your education. If your parents don't speak English language, you won't get support with their homework. So in a way, saying the school is equal and it's open, if you are not looking at those other things happening in the classroom, but also outside the classroom, often you might affect the outcomes for the people you are trying to educate. Okay, so now I have also been trying to read and see what is happening internationally in terms of promoting educational integration. So there are a few programs like mentoring, there are supplementary schooling in immigrant communities whereby, for example, they have language, majority language training. Sometimes they organize summer camps to get migrant children to learn their country languages in order to be able to cope in schools. In some countries, particularly in Germany, for example, they have those programs where they go for talented migrant pupils who may not have the facilities or the capacity to pay for their children's education. So there are many of them that are happening. Those are just some of those I have identified, which I wanted to share. But I would rather probably focus on some of the things that are happening in Dublin, which I was involved in. I'm not saying these are the best. At the same time, I can only talk about things I know, as opposed to, I'm very sure other people might come up with other lists, but I'll talk about the things I know, and you'll allow me to indulge, obviously. Okay, so this is one of the projects I was delighted to be involved in. It was called Pathways to Parental Leadership. It was funded by the European Program for Migration and Integration. The idea was literally to help schools by giving them the tools they could use to engage more effectively with migrant parents. And there is a list of things you can do, and the resources are available. As if I went back to the previous slide, for example, there is a hyperlink on those. So when you use your memory stick here, you can actually get those resources directly. And the Immigrant Council of Ireland, I'm very sure they'll be more than happy to share. The bad news, obviously, the toolkit, this one here, we only managed to print a few. If Fingal County Council want to buy them for their own schools, they can talk to Teresa. And Teresa, I'm very sure, yeah? You are there. You can arrange and make sure they get the material to go for the printers. So I don't think they'll mind about copyrights, by the way, okay? So I better say it. So the toolkit was launched in 2011, and I'm glad to say that the people you see on the slide are actually from your county council. They are from Castahini Educare Together. So just to let you know. So I have also to add a slang, a bit of a finger in what I'm doing. So this is another program which I was involved in, Ambassadors for Change. As you can see, that's a picture which was taken in Dublin, not necessarily in this county council. But obviously it was covered also in newsletters which are circulated in the area. The idea of the program was actually to get people of migrant background who have attended schools in Ireland who will be willing to go back in schools and share their experience of growing up in Ireland, but to the people who may be new, who may be facing their own challenges, and who will say, okay, actually, I'm facing X, Y, and Z, my parents are not educated, why should I be educated? And I don't want to say too much about the people you see in the picture, but I'm very sure someone from our team might know someone who used to present a children's program. The lady who looks Chinese also, she was actually born in Dublin. And then the rest of them, they have their own individual stories. Okay, and I think I have another one. This is Ambassadors for Change. So we had to do a bit of training, obviously. One of the sessions was on the education system in Ireland, because you can't go back and talk to people if you don't know what you are talking about. So we had personal development, communication skills, and then we went out. So this is a picture taken when we had gone to one of the workshops. Okay, this is another program I was involved in, which was looking at young migrants and the challenges they face when it comes to employment. It was an EU-funded project, and it was interesting because at the time when we did it, it was the time when the Equality Authority and DSRI did some sort of mystery research to find out how employers were reacting to diversity. There was a report whereby if you had a name like mine, Mutwarasibo, your application form for a job went directly somewhere. You had to be called Fitzpatrick and so forth in order to go through some entry. So in a way, it was a way of getting some ideas of the experiences, but also trying to get the resources which young migrants could use. So the website is still up and running, and we have a particular section for Ireland, which is, you know, some interactive educational material about writing your CVs and so forth. They are available on the website. Okay. But education is much more than the classroom. It's much more than young people. It is about us. It's about how we move together, how we build our own intercultural competence. It's about how we, as a society, say, yes, you are here, you are acknowledged, you are appreciated. We want you to move along with us. We don't want you to be on your own. It's about challenging some of the perceptions we have about the other. It's about enhancing what it means to be Irish today. So it's great that, for example, we allow anybody to stand and vote in local elections. Yes, our friend is, I shouldn't be saying it, but he's one of the few people born outside the island who have been elected in the county councils. I was delighted in 2007 when Rotimi Adebari became mayor of Portlaoise. You know, it was epoch-making, it was history-making, it was a way of saying, okay, we are actually open, we are welcoming, and I would like to see more and more people actually not only standing for election, but also getting elected. By the way, you know, when they are campaigning, they should refrain from appealing to only one constituency. They have to appeal to everyone, which makes sense. So education is for us, it's also about for everybody else. And I have some practical applications as well. I think it was 2007, the Immigrant Council of Ireland launched another program, which was called Mentoring Program. Part of it was rolled out here in Branchers Town. And the idea of the program was actually to link people who are the so-called mentors and mentees to work on a journey where everybody would benefit. So we were looking particularly for immigrants, but also for people who are established. That's what the term I prefer to use, as opposed to indigenous. It was successful. We documented it. The mentoring program park is available online, and we piloted it outside Dublin City Council area. So we went to Branchers Town, we went to Cork, we went to Limerick, we went to Galway. And there is no reason why you can't do it. And everybody actually needs a mentor. So whatever we do, it's okay to have somebody to bounce your ideas back and from. And when you are going out to speak, for example, you may need to know, okay, what kind of audience am I going to meet? You know, what am I going to say? What is acceptable? What is not acceptable? We can't invent it. Sometimes we need to have some sort of support. Okay, so we are getting very close to the end. Some of you might have seen some posters on buses and trams, on VEDAT and so forth, and I believe this year it went national. There's something else I was involved in shaping, whereby we were encouraging people to talk about diversity, and the Immigrant Council of Ireland has been teaming up with National Transport Authority, Lewis, Dublin Bus, the Irish Rail, as a way of highlighting the fact that they employ migrants, but they also serve migrants. So, and encouraging people to have a dialogue on diversity and talking about discrimination and so forth. So it has been a successful campaign, and I have to say I was delighted a couple of months ago when the city of Rome decided to emulate what Dublin is doing. So there are a few things we are getting right, and we should be celebrating all the time, every time we do it. And I am just about to finish. So I have some food for thought, which I don't need to read. But one of the things I have learned is if you tell somebody they are silly, sometimes they internalize it and they become silly. If you tell them they are intelligent, they will always work hard to become intelligent. So what kind of messages are we giving, whether it is in the classroom or outside the classroom? So when you are giving feedback, we should give positive feedback as much as we can. Sometimes I know it is not possible, but we have to try as much as we can to do it. And then I know something has come up, which is about whether or not people should be encouraged to speak their mother tongues. You know, if you have children, do you speak to them in English? Which language do you use? In actual fact, it's easier to learn a new language if you speak another one. If you can't master your own language, you can't master the new one. But that is not to say that you should not encourage people to speak the dominant language. Far from it, you should. But at the same time, if there are any difficulties, you have to look back at the system. I remember some of the slides I showed earlier on, where there is inclusion for Maori school education, it is easier for children to integrate in school. So the fault is not necessarily the parents. It may be to do with early child education, early childhood education, or lack of it. Okay. So obviously what we are trying to strive for, what we are trying to achieve, is to come to a socially cohesive society, and it will only happen when there is access, when we can achieve our dreams. It will happen when we can be empowered to ask questions. It will work only if we have trust in our institutions as well as in ourselves. And it will only work when we are actually ourselves. We develop a sense of belonging and we say, this is our home, let's make it work for us. And it is on this note that I'll finish with this slide. And again, I started with a story, I tell you a story now. In 2011, I got a phone call from a part of Dublin. This was somebody who was busy hoving in her house and canvassers, she was dealing with the general elections campaign. Canvassers called to her house. She was in a posh area, which will remain nameless for the time being, but she looked Filipino. So when the canvassers came in, they assumed she was a domestic worker. You know, it's okay to be a domestic worker. So two things happened. One is they assumed she didn't speak English. And two, they were looking for the man or the woman of the house. It was her home. She may have looked Chinese or Filipino, but she could vote. She rang the Immigrant Council of Ireland at the time and she said, Fidel, you have to do something. I wasn't sure what I could do, but I said I'd give it a try. So the try, what we did was actually very easy, but it was interesting because it caught people's imagination. We decided to go and look for people who did not look typically Irish, but who could vote in the general elections. And as you can see, the picture was taken actually in front of Leinster House. And we called our campaign at the time Counters In. And I'm glad to say one of the things we called for has actually happened. One of the things we called for was for official recognition of diversity through citizenship ceremonies. I know a few people had been asking for them, and I am glad to say it has since happened. And those people who are becoming citizens today, unlike me in 2003, it is a public ceremony which is actually transmitted through media and so forth to the wider audience. So I want us to be diverse, to be cohesive, to feel at home, and you know, not to be asked all the time, you know, whether we are visiting or not. So I can't be visiting for 20 years. Thank you very much.